continue the lecture. Sorry, I will place my here. Now I will be speaking about this, how we can assimilate some data which comes from observations, from measurements. Particularly, the space and airborne infrared sensors, which is operating from the surface. I hope do you hear me, correct?
Yes.
Do you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes, okay, thank you, thank you. Yeah, because it was something in my computer indicating that it's no microphone. Okay, space, as I mentioned, the space airborne infrared sensors, they allow in general to determine this absolute temperature at the surface of the measured, at the measured area on the surface. And how they are doing, they are at each time step, let's say like that, the satellite or the airborne sensors, they are measure the reflectivity, and then it's, they can tell about the absolute temperature. And from the absolute temperature also, they can understand this or assess the heat flux on the top of the surface. And it is a very important for us to understand the what is the dynamics of the lava within, especially when the lava start to be covered by the crust, and from the top you cannot see the dynamics, how it flows. You know, as I showed your movie, when it is covered by the black pieces, you don't feel lava itself, but suddenly it ruptures and lava comes. It means that the lava is rather hot, and it seeks the area from where it can escape. And that is really important, especially when it's created some cracks, and from these cracks can be even moving outside. And for this aim, a question can be imposed. Is it possible to use the surface thermal data, which can be temperature and the heat flux, if we obtain them? Is it possible to constrain the thermal and dynamic condition beneath the surface? Meaning they say beneath the surface of the measurements, or beneath the crust, for example, of the lava. And that's quite interesting to understand what is the dynamics, what is the temperature, what is the flow within this particular area. Now I will show you again, as usual, it is a set of equations which we solve, and I show you how we optimize this problem. This is a problem related to the determination of the conditions at the low boundary, when we don't know there, meaning that it's here, it is a gamma two. At the gamma two, actually, we don't know temperature. If we know temperature at gamma two, and at the gamma on the surface, just the temperature, we can reconstruct the, some evolution of the, based on the equations, for example, this equation. But we don't know here, but with what we know on the top, we know the temperature and we know heat flow. It's in the forward modeling, it is too much to have two conditions on the top. You can either use a heat flow or the, but when you don't know there is a temperature at the bottom of the layer lava flow, it is impossible to measure. But in this case, it is really very important to have additional knowledge about the temperature, which means that temperature and heat flow, heat flow measurements data. In this case, we can assimilate this data to understand the temperature within the layer, and particularly on the bottom of the layer. Let's consider that what I mentioned is the boundary conditions. Here we have at this boundary, we have a temperature and a flow, because we need to have in the model the some flow which comes with the velocity, let's say U1. And then at this boundary, we know only that it is a there is a no slip conditions. That's why we put U equals zero. At this boundary, we have a some equation. For example, we know temperature, we know that it's a pressure is zero, and we also impose such kind of the conditions that it's on this boundary, which are related to the stress. It's actually the normal stress. It's equal to stress to the normal, it's equal to zero. And at this boundary, which is the most important gamma four, we know, as I mentioned, temperature. As I mentioned, we know heat flow, which we can describe this way. I mean, it's a mathematical, and phi is a measurement. You know the measure. You know T4 as a measurement, part of measurements, and you know phi as a part of measurement. And also there's some condition we impose on the velocity and the relevant tensor of stress sigma. Next step is to develop oscillatory problem. What it means? This problem is estimated in one place, because we have at this boundary, as I already mentioned, two conditions for temperature, but here no condition for temperature, because it's actually, we don't know this temperature condition. We would like to determine this condition. But in the oscillatory, the problem, we tell that let's let temperature at this boundary be T2. We don't know it, just to prescribe some temperature T2. Here is the temperature remains the same, and but we tell that it's no heat fluxes here. We take out the heat flux. In this case, the boundary condition together with the Stokes incompressibility and stationary heat equation becomes the same, actually. And the Stokes incompressibility and stationary equation are the same as in the direct problem. But the conditions are different only for these boundaries, bottom and upper boundaries of the lava flow layer, which are of our interest. Exactly, I mentioned here that two boundary conditions differ. There is the oscillatory problem from the direct problem. But as I mentioned you, we develop a joint to this problem, and then we use a variational approach, which I was talking about during the previous lecture. And in this case, that is our joint. Here I just show the equations, but it's indeed it's based on the some theory, the inversion of the matrix and so on. But the point is that it's nice part of this work was to derive the analytical adjoint. It is really was not a simple problem, but it's still analytical adjoint that is possible to derive. You don't need to use a discrete adjoint like in many cases in atmospheric sciences and so on. It's very complicated when you need to use some additional tools. But here it is possible to develop an analytical adjoint. And in this case, you see that it's at this boundary, we prescribe the difference between the observed heat flux and the heat flux, which will be at this surface, but in the case here, heat flux observed, and this one is a heat flux if we assume that at this boundary, temperature is equal to the temperature C. And in this case, we take such kind of the differences, we insert and we solve. This problem, adjoint problem, is well-posed problem. That's why again, we receive two well-posed problems. One, it is an auxiliary problem, and the second problem is adjoint problem. And solving these two problems forward and backward in time, this one backward in time, and auxiliary problem is forward of time. It is possible to find such a TXC which will give a very small differences to this cost function. Now, a few words about this. I specifically mentioned here, but I read it's a term related to the viscosity. Viscosity is not so simple as, let's say, in the mental dynamics, when we use a viscosity dependent just on temperature and sometimes of the pressure, and rather simple the viscosity relationship. But here it is a lava actually depends not only temperature, but also, as I mentioned, on the volume fraction of crystals. And that is a really very important, because it's the crystallization brings us to the case when you see the so-called black crust, yeah, on the top, because it's the crystals. And crystals are developed based on the various issues, for example, degassing. It gives a raise to the crystallization as well as the temperature. With the cooling, the number of the crystals increase and so on, and the volume fraction of crystals increase. And here it's the equations which correlate this crystal content. This is the volume fraction of crystals, phi, and actually this phi, but it's the ratio is such phi. Open phi, and this is a closed phi. And this is a function which tell us about the F function, which are inserted into this equation. What is important? How this relates to temperature? And you can see here theta, and this theta is related such a way where the Ts is the temperature of crystallization. Particularly for some lavas, it can be a little bit over the 1000 Kelvin. Other parameters are mentioned here, but right now it is not necessary to go in details of these things. There are publications and you can look at these parameters. Most important issue is that it's a function of viscosity or rheology of lava is rather complicated in this case, because it takes into account there is a not only the temperature, but also how temperature influences the crystallization of the lava to generate this core. And again, it's just returning back and reminding you what means the variation or adjoint method. We, as I showed, this create this norm, or here it's integral. It is a cost function, and we would like to minimize here heat flux. Here is heat flux. It is coming from the observations. And here we see we have a temperature as a solution of auxiliary problem, because auxiliary problem it is possible to be solved because we you know the transfer there is one of the condition from the top or the upper surface to the lower surface. In this case, it's possible to solve this problem as a direct problem. And there is the auxiliary problem and say the solution, and we insert and we get a some heat flux in this case. And we would like to optimize this difference to get then finally such a temperature which will get us closer to the measured heat flux distribution. As I mentioned, that in this case also it is possible to prove that it's this equation, this objective function has a unique minimum, and we would search for this unique minimum using the gradient of the objective functional. But again, I don't show here the how we derive here and the all methods and so on, how we use it. Again, it is a something long story, but it is everything is written and possible to read, and I will refer you to if you are interested to the, our publications where it is everything is in details described. Now it is a last slide of this this part of the, my presentation related to the case study, and we had a flow on the from the volcano. From here, it is a vent here, and this is a gauss flow down toward the area. I mean, this you see here the dimensions of the model domain. Here you see the cross section along of this line. Here is cross section, and this is the all lava. And what we did, we took this part, and we wanted to understand the temperature and dynamics of the lava flow within this part. And this is a result of our assimilation, actually. And you see that it's a crust which has developed. This is a color is a brown, and blue is a lava which flows. And this is actually viscosity. There's a one, blue is something like a one viscosity. Again, it is a dimensionless. And three order of magnitude higher is a viscosity of the crust on the top. Here you see the temperature, and temperature difference is from 3.6 to 4.4. Again, non-dimensional temperature here. And you see that here is the temperature are high. It is indeed, there is a lava within the bottom of the channel is really much hotter than on the top. And here it is a crust becomes it's a more thick if we consider this whole crust, but here is a viscosity in this scale. But when you look in the temperature, you can see the stratification within the crust. This is the most, let's say, colder part of the crust, and here it is a less colder part of the crust. And finally, you see here the velocity, how the lava moves with which velocity, what is the where the velocity is higher, where its velocity is smaller, and indeed the velocity at the bottom is zero and close to zero, because as a boundary condition, the velocity imposed to be zero at the straight at the boundary of between the let's say land and the lava on which the land lava flows. And now I will speak about this problem of the adjoint, just a few things about the residuals, because it's very important to see that at the beginning, when we don't know exactly what was the temperature below, because our aim is reconstruct this temperature below. And once we reconstruct the temperature below, we just once solve the problem forward in time, and we found the, all these things, you know, all viscosity, temperature, viscosity, and velocity can be found the strive forward when we know the temperature at the bottom, but we don't know. That's why we prescribe some temperature there. And when we prescribe some temperature, the first iteration is looks very bad. You see, this is just worse. It's if you compare it to the scale, it's a very bad first iteration. It's residuals here. Here, temperature residual, and this is a velocity residual. And you see that it's a very big velocity residual here, especially in this part, which is a brown part. But with after the 30 iterations, at the 31st iteration, you could see that it's almost very well we reconstruct. That means that, what means that actually residual? Residual means exactly there is a difference between the temperature which is, let's say, known, and the temperature which we can reconstruct. And there's here it's also the temperature residual, here viscosity residual, temperature residual, and the velocity residual after the 30 iterations. Meaning that it's 30 iterations is not a lot, and it is possible to resolve these things. Actually, it works quite well. But it's very important. First of all, as you remember, this is a steady state problem, meaning that we assume that the flow, one established, becomes the same during the time. Means no change, because it's steady state flow, no change in the flow patterns. It is not true, actually. Yeah. Because it is a flow change with time. And to do it, you need to introduce additional term in the heat equation. And in this case, adjoint is a very difficult, if possible, to derive analytically. In this case, you have to go to the discrete case, or we did it. That's a fantastic, but it's in our group, some mathematicians did it. They derived this, the analytical side, but it is intractable to be solved, you know. And it's, they spent about this several months to derive this analytically, but it becomes a really intractable problem. And that's why we thought about some other methods in determining, let's say, viscosity within the lava flow or lava domes, because we started to be interested in lava domes as well. Well, now I will finish this part. This is related to the lava flow. That's the meaning that it's what I showed you. It's we propose, our group proposes it's some approach to the solving the optimal boundary control problem arising in the studies of lava dynamics. And with really, let's say, increasing the quality of, sorry, not quality, probably it's good sense, the resolution of satellite apparatus, radar observations on the lava thickness, volume, flow extents. Indeed, the methodology will give more exciting results in terms also of resolution. And maybe even we can reduce the number of iteration and so on, depending on the accuracy what we wish to get. And this is some technology which we started to develop recently. And this can give some this approach can give further consideration for the inversions using the observations in the lava flow. Okay, I thank you for this part, but I will move to another part. I am very sorry that it is not within the one. I couldn't just make these things happen. I will stop screen now, and I will open another file. Sorry, it's I closed things today. Okay, that's another file related to the type of, it is not a machine actually, learning, but type of the vision. Okay. I hope you see my screen and here. Well, that is something which is related to predicting of viscosity of lava dome by analyzing its observed morphology. I am very sorry, I wanted to show you it's really the how exciting are the lava domes. You know, the lava domes are like a mountain operating within the, you know, small window of time. You know, you can see within small window of time, let's say several years, how mountain looks like. Definitely it is not mountain, it's something which can be big, like a 60 to 100 meters in the length, you know, and up to about also 100 meters to the in the height. And suddenly you see that something start to go upward. You know, it moves, it sometimes collapse and there comes some lava flow and then again, it is a grow and so on. I am very sorry, but I had no time to show you a movie. Movie is fascinating. But anyway, here at the background, probably you see this part of the lava dome on the top. And what is the exciting point of lava domes is the following. Initially, they looked like, oh, very interesting things. Look, it is like a, you know, growth of a mountain. you never see actually how the mountain grows. But when you look at the, you are curious, oh, what is the fantastic things? Definitely, you don't see it like within several seconds it's growing. No, but within the time scale, if it's, you know, your time scale, something several months to years, you could see the how the dome grows up. And if it is a recorded, you know, for example, by permanent, the video recording can, then it's merged the each slides, and you can see it's really fantastic. That's a USGS did actually, and this is a part of the movie of USGS. But anyway, this is an exciting point. But what is the most after the excitement of the evolution, and another part of excitement of the nature, but there is another very dangerous part, because this is seems to be very peaceful development of domes, sometimes can rupture occasionally, meaning the collapsing the part of the dome, and the pyroclastic flow can come. And the pyroclastic form is awful. It is many things, it's mixing together, and it's moving down of slope with a very high speed, and it's everything, it's what is coming based on the way, it's just, you know, eliminates on the way of the motion. That is a very dangerous part of the dome, lava dome. That's why it is very important to understand the internal structure of the dome, especially, for example, what is the viscosity? Even the viscosity is small in the, let's say, in the core of the dome, it can generate the such kind of, if during the long period of time they are developing, the generation is probably not immediate, but indeed it can be because of the, you know, the gassing and the coming a new portion of the lava from the same vent, and then it can collapse because of the very high very high pressure, and also very high, the, let's say, column conditions, column stress conditions within the carapace or the uppermost cover of the dome. And if you can calculate these things and so on, or estimate them, that will be great to understanding of hazards of collapsing of the dome and generating the very hazardous flow. Well, now, we would like to solve some inverse problem using the shape of the lava dome. For example, there are different types of the lava dome. Here it is from the work of the one of the group of the volcanologists from UK, and they studied the specific domes in the field, and you see such kind of lava domes, which they sometimes call the, it's you know, the walls, not sorry, not walls, it's obelisks, you know, and because they look like obelisks, you know, that's what we did recently, the last year, published this modeling. And you see that it's in the form of the obelisk, you know, it's going upward. And here it is a rather less viscous part of the internal of this, but on the surface, it becomes a very viscous part, or the carapace here. You know, this is another structure, and also here model structure. This is the third type of the structure. Also, we model this way. But the point is the following. If you have a S0 as a shape of the observed dome, you know, here is on one side of the left-hand side is observed. And you have a shape of model flow for a lava dome here. But this model lava dome shape depends strongly on viscosity. Then you can construct your norm or your residual, simply speaking, with respect, and can minimize this difference with respect to viscosity. And this way we try to solve the inverse problem and to find the lava viscosity this way. Just looking on morphology. Look here on the left, look here on the top, on the right, and tell. This is correct or not. But, well, it looks like exactly this, for example, this uppercase, it looks like obvious. But this is we need to understand what is the viscosity inside, correct? And for this aim, what we did, that is our approach, very recently developed. We just this year published this. It's a very recently development. And sorry, I didn't mention, actually, this is developed by the first author, which I put here. It is a Yulia Starodubtseva. She did the basic calculations and so on. And the point is that here, first of all, we developed a series of the based on the model of the lava dome evolution, which we use. And particularly, again, I don't show the all equations this time, but it's, I would like just to mention, it is, again, you can, I can give you an exact reference. You can go there to the paper and see these all details of the study. But the most important issue here is that we use the dependence viscosity, which depends essentially of crystal content, meaning that it's crystals play the principal role, and crystallization is because of degassing. Degassing, when there is magma moves to the top of the surface, it starts to, the pressure drops down, there is, it becomes, the gases start to go away. And with this, the crystallization start to play a very essential role. And when it comes to the surface, it's already rather crystallized. That is why it is not a flow immediately down of slope, like in the case of the lava flow, because already on the top, the lava is quite high viscosity. It's around 10 to the 10 Pascal second, something like that, or 10 to the 9 at that. At the beginning, and then it grows up to the 10 to the 12, even higher, 10 to the 15. Then we consider lava viscosity as a control variable in our case. Then the third part of our approach is that we run a set of experiments depending on the control variable, meaning that the lava viscosity, which depends on the time, and we create a very big database of morphological forms of the model lava domes. What it means? It means we have a model, we develop many lava domes shapes, how they look like. It is, you know, going up, it is a more shaped like, for example, lobes, yeah, like you showed, or it's a very thin, it's called sometimes it's a pancake structures and so on. Anyway, we develop a many based on this principle control variable, meaning the lava viscosity. It means that the shapes, morphological shapes of the lava dome depends on the viscosity. And we are just going calculating, and they're feeding the database. Then we compare the observed lava dome morphology. We have some observations in the field. We take this morphological shape and we find such a model shape, which gives a really very close fit to the observed one. Meaning, again, searching for the model lava shape, lava dome shape, which fits or match the best way, the shape of the observations. Particularly, we consider this computer vision technique, and I will show you what it means in a few slides later. It is, can be considered as a part of the pattern recognition, as a part of the, let's say, artificial intelligence and so on. And indeed, the machine learning can be taught this way, you know, that's how to distinguish fast way between these many lava shapes which model develops. Actually, model can be not a unique model, can be different models. You know, we use this viscosity, we can use another viscosity and so on. But anyway, once we have the many of such kind of the model shape, we can use a computer vision technique to understand this, which model dome shape, morphological shapes, it's match the morphological shape of the observed. Now we consider the viscosity of the model dome domain, which shapes fit the shape of observed dome in the best fit. That is our aim, and it's we can tell about the, our lava viscosity then. Okay, well, this is a very fast again, this set of equation which we use, and I specifically highlighted viscosity, which as already I showed, depends on the flow and indeed depends on the phi is a content of the crystals. And this is a model like that. It is the lava is going through the actually the magma, but it's when it's on the top of the surface, it becomes lava and to the air and start to develop the lava dome here. Again, in the, some cases, it's come on the top, on the surface, very low viscosity, and it flows down and it creates a lava flow. But when it's, the viscosity is high, then it creates a dome. It's like a big dome. You saw what when I showed you. Here I already showed this, you initial this, how we calculate, but in this specific case, we consider more complicated this equation by replacing the phi, which are found in the previous case through temperature. We consider it a kinetics equation, meaning that this, we consider how we really understand the changes with time of the crystal content, content using this equation. And tau is called, sometimes it is a so-called is a characteristic, actually it's called sometimes the relaxation time, but it is a characteristic time of the crystal content growth, meaning that it's a, we know this characteristic time, for example, that we know that within the 5 days, crystals reach this level. You know, and we tell them, oh, okay, tau is like that. And that's that. But a phi equal equilibrium here, meaning that it's a phi cannot be actually in the nature equals one. One actually means that it's everything is already crystal. There is no any fluid there. There is no any lava. Everything is crystallized. But normally, even when we see a hard lava, they inside they have something like 10% is not a fully crystallized material, and that's why equilibrium is something like 0.8 or 0.9 in between. This is a equilibrium, so-called equilibrium. That's why the volcanologist tells that if you reach the equilibrium of the crystals, that means that it's, you are almost done in terms of the crystallization of lava. This is from 1 hour work. It's just to show the different shapes of the lava, which depends on the viscosity indeed, but as well as from this tau with the so-called relaxation time, and also depends on the extrusion of the lava, meaning the rate of extrusion, or in the volcanological community, it's called discharge rate. It's what is the discharge of the lava on the top. This is just to show how this model works and how we use this model to generate different shapes of the lavas, different shape of morphological shape of lavas. Finally, we develop here, I show there's something like 300 different cases with a different tau, with a different radius of vent, with a different time scale steps, etc. And we had all this information in the, our data set. Now comes the most important issue, that it's our examples, which we developed. And this is, we don't preserve all details. for us, most important is only the top morphological shape. Why? Because in the field, you don't know what is inside. You would like to understand what is inside, but you know quite well the shape of your dome, how the dome looks like. Here is, as you know, isosymmetric problem because it's a mathematical formulation. That's why it is just a half of the dome. But dome is like that, you know, it's another part is here, another part is here. You know, but it's just a part of these things because of the isosymmetric. Yeah, and here I indicated this word, but actually it was accepted in 20, but published in 21. Now, that is a very important issue. What we mean when we are talking about the computer vision models. Here is some fun for you. Probably when you were a little girl and little boy, you were interested to look in the book and your parents gave you and told, look, where is there is a difference between these two, you know, the very identical the pictures. Find these differences. You know, okay, well, we are human, yeah? We are very good in finding the difference in picture, especially if we are giving some time for doing so like that. And you can see that is the first difference I marked by red, yeah? Oops, sorry. And there is another difference also, etc. I don't show this all of them, but you can find it's a difference by difference. And on the top, another one, it's a cloud, it's missing here, and here is vegetation and so on. But anyway, that is something important. What it means actually, it means that how to teach computer to recognize these differences. It is a part of this computer vision or the part of the pattern recognition or the part of the artificial intelligence which we use. But everything is actually based again on the inversions, based on the inverse problems, based on the, let's say, assimilation of some knowledge about this thing. And this is also the exciting work done by Wang et al. In 2005, when he polluted the shape of the photo by, as you see, that's a famous Albert Einstein, and this is the original image, and they distort this original images with some technique, and then they try to recognize who is here, and this is again the methods of the computer vision helps in doing so. And recognizing. It is one of the methods which we use also for recognition differences between the model example and the real example in the Earth. Here you see the shape of our observed lava dome. Let's see, that is the shape of observed lava dome. And this is what we are doing, first of all. We discretize our area where the shape is located. And we prescribe within the each small cell one if the area is covered by the lava dome and zero if the area is not covered. It means we know if we will take now out the shape, we know the approximately, and definitely it will depend on the discretization of the model domain, we will know where the lava is located. Here I describe in some details of the how this way we are managing with these things and so on. But the most important issue now is to define these so-called quality functions. And the quality functions which we consider are three. For the first model, we use a very simple one. It's called symmetric difference-based functional. What it means actually, what it means actually, it means that we take two domains here, look here, L star and here L star prime. And then we take difference, it should be prime, was, yeah, well, this one. We took the, we take the both volumes of these domes, and we take the intersection of these domes, and we create the function which we try again to minimize, where the S is in meter square, is the area of the domain for the L star is observed, and L is model, and that is a to guess how they look, it's they are shaped together, and how it looks at the intersection of these two shapes. It is a one of the simple method. It's just looking at how areas are fit each other, one and another. But in the simplest way, it's not sometimes gives a rather good result, but still alone. But we have another method. It is called the peak signal to noise ratio. And this functional is constructed this way. It's more complicated way, but still is it possible? Because what means PEG? It means that it's exactly this small cells. What is the value in these small cells, one or zero? You know, you can insert here, you calculate this functional, and then you can look at what which of the all model shapes give a better fit. I mean, which minimize J2 better. Then you can tell, okay, well, this model better characterize the present observed structure. And then we can look what is the structure, internal structure of the this particular dome. And the final one, which I showed in there is respect to the Albert Einstein image, which we disturb, it is a structural similarity. And this is more based on the statistical and it's a probabilistic assessment of the possibility of the changing of the shape. And the, you know, here is introduced expected values, covariance, it's the dispersion, this is a more, let's say it's not just based on the structure, but based also on on similarity, structural similarity, not only based on the just observation of the difference between the shape, but also structural similarity, which tells about the what is the change of the curve itself, which is the morphological shape. Finally, we are doing the following. For each, for example, we have here, you see observed the dome, and here it's the different the shapes of the domes which we calculated. What the algorithm is doing is going through the all this set and select the best which gives a rather good fit. And how we are doing it is just looking at the functional J1, J2, J3. This is J, J1, J2, and J3. And here it is a value of this functions, of this functional. And this is a number of the model lava dome. And you see for some of them are, for example, here is a 9 different. And for some of them, the difference is very big, telling that it is not the case. For example, this doesn't fit this one at all. Yeah, but some of them, it's fitted quite well. And that's why we can consider that this is a 4 gives a rather well this fit to the observations. Once we chosen this most appropriate, which is a, let's say 135, F135, we can take this model and can tell, look, we now know the lava viscosity of this model dome, and it is a one of the best approximation to the shape of the this shape of the lava, best approximation to the shape of the observed dome. And that's why we can consider this lava viscosity as a target viscosity for the dome which we have as observations, from observations. And in this case, we can characterize the internal structure of the lava dome, because we know it is this case. And I think that is all what I wanted to tell you about these methods of the computer vision, or tell the artificial intelligence or pattern recognition. I mean, it's something which compare the observed shape with the model shape. And if you have a very big database, you can find the best the fit to the observations, and you can tell that the viscosity inside is very close to the viscosity of what is the fits observations. Well, that's the two books which I would recommend you if you are interested to look in, and you will find there within the right hand side, on the right hand side, the book written together with the Russian mathematicians, applied mathematicians and pure mathematician. It's about the data-driven numerical modeling in geodynamics and some methodology and some application here. On the left-hand side, it is a book which published about in 2010, yes, 10 years ago, more, 11 years ago. And it is related to computational method, which we use actually to solve the problems in geodynamics in data assimilation and in inverse model problems and so on. That's the, principle sets of the methods in use in geodynamics. Okay, that's all what I wanted to tell you. Thank you very much for your patience and for your attention. And now I will look at see if there are some questions, but you can unmute and you can ask me any question, please, if you want. Just now. Oh, Ilya, yeah, you are here. Thank you very much.
Absolutely, absolutely. I came a little bit later.
Yeah, yeah. You didn't know that I will give the talk. There is a problem because it's Vasily is in Seattle and you are in US, close to the Seattle, and you know that Seattle is outage, no power there.
That's why I was late today. We have the same issue here. I still have
same
internet.
Issue.
Yeah,
oh
yeah.
My God, I see. Yeah, that's why
internet, but no phone. Yeah.
Yeah. That's why I jumped in, and you know, it's instead of morning.
Thank you, Alik.
Yeah.
I'm just noticing that there is a question from Igor Collins in the chat. You might want to start with this one.
Yes, could you? Because it's I don't see.
Yeah, it says why equation doesn't take into account the friction forces, since we know that lava is a viscous fluid.
Yes, well, that is a very good question. Actually, there is some other investigations. We didn't use a friction forces, friction law at the bottom of the lava and the topography on which the lava flows. But there are some, we just use the no slip condition, now, which is appropriate in many models of the flow, lava flow. And at the same time, there is also is the possibility to introduce a friction law, and this gives something in between the free slip condition and the no slip condition. It's some term. We did such kind of investigation to understand how it looks, but in some simple cases, when the lava just flow gravitationally, I mean, it's without the heat equation there, and we looked at how it propagates, lava propagate in the terms of the no bound, no slip condition, free slip condition, and the friction condition imposed on the topography on which the lava flows. Yeah, good question. There is some new.
Thank you. Yeah, there are more questions in the chat. Do you want me to read them or you can
yes,
see
yes, please.
Them?
Yeah, if you are, yeah.
Yeah, I, so I, another question is from Javed Rauf. I need to know the best way to estimate the damping, station correction, and seismic tomographic inversion.
Javed, you consider that it's the right question addressed to me. You know, I will tell it. I don't know this. I mean, I cannot tell you as an expert about these things about damping and so on, especially station correction, because it's, I am not dealing with the seismic tomography inversion. But I can tell you that on Wednesday, if I am correct, yes, on Wednesday, please attend this, the lecture by Professor Fichtner from the ETH Zurich. He is one of the well-known experts in the seismic tomography imaging, and he understands these things quite well. And this Andreas can tell you about this all the inversions. It's called this solving large seismic inverse problem with smarter methods. He is really one of the bright early career or mid career scientists who are dealing with such kind of things. Sorry, I can't answer this. It's not topic of my research. That's why it's a very specific question. Anyway, thanks.
And another question from Igor Collins. Can you share the quote of the second part of your lecture?
Yes, we can share the quote, but again, there is you mean it's a quote which is introducing the inversions. This quote, you mean? There are many quotes behind. You know, a quote, for example, for forward modeling is one quote, but the quote for the inverse modeling is quite different quote because it's a joint is added inside. Actually, there is all these things is done within the so-called Fluent software, but there are program which it was written and incorporated in the Fluent. For example, they cannot do a joint, you know, but we did analytically, we derived that joint, and then we inserted inside of the Fluent this as an additional part for calculations. But that's why it is not assumption, something like, you know, C++ code or the, it is in written in C++, but it is just a part of the code, which is inserted in the main code, which is called the Fluent or ANSYS Fluent. You can search in the internet and you can find it's a very useful code for fluid dynamics modeling. And, but definitely any code is limited by something what is written and placed inside. And there is no inverse problems inside of this code. But it's a very helpful to solve the forward models. That's why we insert the code inside of this when we are solving these joints backward in time. Yes. Or particularly this one, it was not a backward in time, but this was this for lava, if you are speaking about, this is for determining these boundary conditions, because it was some optimization of the conditions in the model. Yes.
Thank you, Alik. And Igor, it might be, okay, Igor is saying that you answer his question. Nice. Thank you. You can just unmute yourself and ask questions if you have. You don't have to put them in the chat. Anyone else?
You know the point now, I understand, because it's, I have also a private chat with one of the participants, and I couldn't say, now I understand the way how to do it. Yeah, okay. Because it's, some people hesitate to ask, you know, for everybody, ask me directly. But anyway, it's a very good questions and so on, and I answer also directly. Yeah, okay.
Please, any other questions to Alik? I see that there is some activity in the chat, but no direct questions.
Yeah, probably everybody already tired. Yeah. Tomorrow, by the way, Ilya, it's Dr. Tsitov, he agreed, Vasily agreed that he will be speaking at the second part of the day, but not from 15 to 17 as was planned my lecture, but it will be shifted by 2 hours down to his lecture will start at 5 p.m. The local time.
Like today.
Like today, because it's because of him we shifted 2 hours down.
Yeah. I see.
Yeah. You are working with geodynamics. I had a question related to my results. Yes, go forward. Yeah, because it's you asked me something about seismic tomography, and I told you I did something which to transfer the seismic tomography image to temperature, and I can tell you many things about it, but not exactly dealing with the station, you know, the corrections and so on for the seismic tomography, because it's a different area. I don't actually work with seismic tomography imaging. But if it is your questions related to geodynamics, please go ahead. No, but I already explained, somebody asked this question about the responses. The processes responsible for rollback. As you know, there are several of them, but it's one of the principal issue. It's the gravitational, actually, the sliding. It means that it's when it's a slab penetrates, the, for example, the continental, sorry, it's a oceanic slab goes below this continental lithosphere, it goes at some specific angle. It's not a penetrate, you know, perpendicularly. It's go with some slope, but with when it's progressing its flow, it is a go down, and because of the gravity forces, it starts to, you know, the slope of the, let's say, top surface of the slab starts to increase, and is at some, and this is increasing, and also the movements here of the slab backward because of the, again, the some generation of the crunch of the, this area. But again, it is mostly comes from the some modeling. I personally didn't make such a modeling. I did, but there are many issues with this modeling. You know, this modeling should consider, for example, at this point where the trench is developed, some very specific condition. Otherwise, your movements will be like that, and that is all, but not a retreating. That's why you need some specific conditions here and so on in the modeling to understand how it retreats and so on. It's not a simple things. And also, I got a thinner plate on the top. Yes, you mentioned it, the top at the depths of 20, 50. After that, 300, it goes into, yes, correct. You know why? Because you use a viscous material, most probably, not elastic, but, or viscoelastic. And so I don't know exactly, but it looks like, you know, the when you push some material here, and it is a viscous material, because of the viscosity below, this start not to go straight down, but also it's a stackle at the area and start to become to generate like a bubble, you know, big bubble. That's why it becomes really thicker at some specific depths and so on. Probably that is a you meaning that it's a, it is was thinning and then it after tens it becomes rather thick. Maybe this. But again, it's you are giving some short information. We needed to see how you develop these things. You saw, for example, I showed this some relic slab in branch region, and it's how we did modeling. And it is the same. Initially, it is a rather small, I mean, it's actually, I did this modeling many times years ago, but I remember it was just like a parallelepiped, you know, it's introduced. And then it becomes a very thin on the top and it is a rather thick down because of the gravitational flow, actually. And because this was a very simple model of gravity flow. And that's why it showed that it's, with depth, it becomes a thicker. Yeah, exactly, to mantle flow, it's related indeed. And is I don't read it. Can you please relate it to the mantle flow? Yeah, it is related to mantle flow because it's within the mantle, this goes. But again, it's I don't know this rheology of the slab. If it is the rheology of the slab, also viscous rheology, and the mantle is also viscous, that's exactly what you have to receive. It is nothing strange. But if it is a more nonlinear different rheology, let's say more elastic or plastoelastic and so on, the development will be different. Okay, good. You are welcome. Okay, if no any further question, probably we can finish today's session, and also we can enjoy the evening or afternoon, depending where you are. Yeah, and let's say we will see each other tomorrow. Tomorrow we have two lectures. The first lecture will be about the data assimilation of volcanic clouds. I told you that it will be given by the, but you know, the, all our speakers are in critical situation. They say, Arnaud, he's a really very, very good scientist and so on, but he's on the top of the scientific hierarchy related to the disasters in the country, in Spain. And that's why he's every day was called to the some, you know, emergency committee, planning committee meetings and so on. Actually, we last minute changed his presentation to this day because he promised to be free morning on Tuesday, tomorrow. That's why I hope we will get Arnaud tomorrow, and he will be speaking about this volcanic clouds, which where he's expert, but most probably also he will tell us something about the ongoing eruptions at Etna. About they are also eruptions and clouds there, because the clouds also were quite prominent in this during these eruptions. And the second will be evening, early evening present lecture by Vasily. Okay, that is all. Okay, just enjoy your evening. and goodbye. Ilya, thank you very much.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Alik, again.
Nice presentation. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Bye.